So it's often believed that Jacobites were only Scottish Catholics. It's not the case. To be a Jacobite, you could be from any of the four nations. So you could be Scottish, English, Welsh or Irish. As long as you supported the Stuart claim, it honestly didn't matter. And same for the faith, they weren't just Catholic. There were Protestants that followed the Stuarts as well, because again, they believed they were still the rightful kings and heirs to their throne. So here we have Maria Clementina Sobieska. She was one of the wealthiest heiresses in Europe at the time, and it was very quickly decided that she would be the perfect match for James Francis Edward Stuart. She's got the money, James got the name and the claim to the throne. There would be a perfect union. Unfortunately for her and James, the Hanoverian king at the time, George I, was not delighted with the prospect of a union, for he feared it would produce heirs. He was absolutely right, it did. So this proud and cheerful picture, we actually have the young bonny Prince Charlie, or Charles Edward Stuart as he's officially known. In this portrait, he's actually 12 years old, and it presents a real feeling of positivity for the exiled Stuarts. He's still presented in his royal regalia, you know, he's still got the symbol of England, his bright colours, the Order of the Garter, again, across, you know, he's chivalrous, he's noble, he's everything you want in a future king. The only thing that's missing, unfortunately, is their throne at this time. He was very much known to be the favourite of his mother, Maria, whereas Henry tended to be the favourite of their father, James. He is most well known for the 1745 Rising, which has been increased recent years due to Outlander. He very much comes over and raises his standard up in the north near Fort William, and then the clans will go, they join, and he decides to make his way down into England. So obviously he goes to Edinburgh, and within 2 days he's welcomed into Edinburgh, he's handed the keys. They win the Battle of Falkirk Muir, they win the Battle of Prestonpans, and then they make their slow descent into England. Now it's known when they arrive in Manchester, they arrive to adoring crowds. There is cheering, there is clapping, everybody is genuinely pleased to welcome this prince into their city. For me, it shows still how divided the support was between the Stuarts and the Hanoverians. There were stories of other places where they'd come into and they simply weren't welcomed at all, which is unfortunate. I think what they sort of hoped is when they got over that border, the other Jacobites were emerged. Now they make it all the way to Derby in England, which is a considerable way down. They're only a couple of hundred miles away from London. The Hanoverians are so scared by this fact that the Hanoverians actually flee London at this time. Unfortunately, they decide to turn back. I certainly believe it's the biggest mistake they make. I firmly believe they could have taken London with them gone. But again, you know, we'll never know. Instead, he decides to listen to his generals, which I think at a time for somebody in such a position shows a lot of forethought. You know, Outlander often present him as a bit of an idiot, to be honest. They show him as this sort of complete mix of culture, which he was. You would have had the English, the French, and the Italian. But you've got to, he was a highly educated and sophisticated man. He would have known his stuff. He would have had the very best education for when they gained that throne back. So a lot of the lies that are told tend to go back to that rumour mill of Parliament and spreading the word amongst the people that he's not competent, that he speaks in an Italian accent, so naturally he's a foreigner, so we don't want a foreigner on the throne, even though they currently had essentially somebody from a German line on the throne. It's very hypocritical and it doesn't sort of make much sense at the time. What you find, it's unfortunately in some places that rumour mill starts to work, and it's still present to this day. Personally, I don't believe he was stupid at all. I actually think, much like his ancestors, he was quite liberal in his thought. He was willing to listen to what people had to say and to listen to their opinions. But I think what ended up being his downfall was he had generals who had no idea about the lay of the land. You know, they were all Scottish and Irish generals, which would have been fantastic in Scotland. But when you were down in England, it left you with a shortfall. So they decide to turn home, what is potentially one of the worst winters, I think, on record. You know, they're running out of money, they don't have much food, and obviously the numbers start to drop off and people start to desert as they get closer and closer to home. Now, when they do get home, eventually they're forced back up to Inverness and to Culloden, and then they suddenly realise one morning that they're going to have to face the enemy. By that point, the troops, or the Parliament troops, have made it back. I should say the government troops, sorry, have made it back into the country. And they've manoeuvred them within a pincer movement. So one part of the army has gone to the north, the other half has come to the south. And unfortunately for the Jacobites, they were forced onto the Culloden battlefield, which took place on April the 16th in 1746. Sources tell us that the battle was over in 45 minutes. It didn't last long at all. When you look at the firearms of the Jacobite side, you know, the famous Highland charge, the swords, against the muskets and the cannons of the Hanoverian government troops, it wasn't going to last long. And unfortunately, it pretty much put an end to any thought of a Jacobite rising ever coming back. Now, he very quickly, obviously the most famous song, the Boat of Skye, he escaped to Skye, and then he was managed to make it back across to France. However, France, the French king, his cousin, had made an agreement with the English king at this time that if they wanted a friendly relationship between France and Britain, then the French king was to exile his cousin, which he did. He forces him back to Italy. I think Charles had a real fear for some reason of ending up in Poland, or what would be known as sort of Poland today. I suppose after maybe the level of culture he was used to, you know, especially if you're looking at the Vatican and you're looking at France, that they are cultural hubs throughout history. There is just so much going on. So maybe to go back to this country that's maybe not as influenced at the time would have been a complete shock to him. He would have been devastated. And what we actually see is him presented here later on in life. So this portrait is a copy based on the small one here. And you see even later on in life, he's still presenting himself as a king, the same way his father has done. He's shown in his armor, and just in the background are the crown jewels. You've got the imperial crown, you have the orb, and you have the scepter. He's still telling you he's still the king across the water, and he's still here. Sources tell us that actually at one point in history, he snuck back in to England and dressed as a commoner and went around to try and get a feel to see what people's opinions were and if there was ever a chance for another uprising to take place. And unfortunately, I think he was very devastated by what he found, that by that point people had just maybe come to accept the change that was in place, and very much just went to live out the rest of his days in Italy. In this cabinet here, you have a few references to the Stuarts, but most importantly, you have the enameled gold watch that actually belonged to Bonnie Prince Charlie. And what you can see on the reverse through the mirror is actually a small enameled portrait of his daughter, Charlotte, the Duchess of Albany. Unfortunately, when Charlotte was born, she was an illegitimate child from Charles's mistress, but he actually had her legitimised before he died. I think it was maybe his hope that she might take up the claim for the throne, but it was obviously sort of well attested by that point. She'd never been to the United Kingdom. She didn't speak English. It wouldn't have been taken favorably. You know, people of Britain, they didn't know who this woman was. They simply knew that she was the daughter of Prince Charles. But it also gives for me an indication for somebody that their relationship was meant to be so fraught and difficult, that even on his deathbed, she left her three children, I think, with a carer, and went and looked after Charles on his deathbed. And she obviously meant something to him if he carried her around on the pocket watch on the reverse side, and encased within jewels. I think it speaks volumes, actually, about what he really thought of her. The other piece we have here is a ring. So obviously, if you were to show support for the Jacobites, you would have immediately have been branded a traitor. It was not something you outwardly did. So obviously, the Jacobites came up with several symbols and several sayings that If you knew what you were looking for, you would recognise another Jacobite in front of you. So the example we have in this case is actually a ring, which is meant to contain a lock of Bonnie Prince Charlie's hair. And she would have just, somebody would have worn it on their hand. Obviously the other symbols are the white rose for the Jacobites, the oak tree. They used to raise a toast, so she'd have to toast to the king across the water. Another one was to the gentleman in the little black cape, which was essentially referring to the mole that had dug the hole that William of Orange's horse fell over and caused him to die.
Thank you so much for watching these videos about the Scottish Catholic Heritage Collections Trust and our wonderful treasures. Blair's Museum is located just outside of Aberdeen, and we are open from April until September. And you can learn about visiting arrangements and how to book your ticket at www.schct.org.uk. And when you get here, you can learn all about the history of Catholicism, Mary Queen of Scots, the Jacobites. You can help us by purchasing goods from our shop. You can also do that online, or you could also support us by donating to us online.